Hello, founders, and welcome to the Gab Lab. This is a show that is sharing with you financial information that is going to blow your mind, but more importantly, it's going to help you build your bottom line. I'm your show host, Tanya Woods Richardson, and today's champ of this episode is Community Futures of Saskatchewan with 13 offices across the province to help founders, entrepreneurs like you build their business and nail their numbers. So today's episode, I'm actually really pumped about today's episode. We have Stan Swartz here to join us, president of Info Money Solutions, Inc. And Stan, you're following two rather heavy episodes. 2 weeks ago, we were talking all about insolvency and bankruptcy. And then last week, we were talking about debt and how to hopefully get out of it and turnarounds and restructuring. So heavy, heavy conversations. I'm not going to suggest tax is a light conversation, but it's a need to do, right? Death and taxes, as they say, the cliche. So welcome to the show, Stan. It's great to have you here.
Thank you. Appreciate you inviting me.
Well, as always, you know what's as always, let me finish that thought. We're going to break this segment down. If you haven't guessed it already, we're going to be talking all about taxes. And basically the topic is quarterbacking your tax return. I was trying to figure out why I had football on the brain. And then I realized that we have Super Bowl coming up this weekend. So now I realize why I was thinking along those lines. But as with every segment, we're going to break this topic down into three kind of bite-sized manageable chunks. The first one, we're going to talk about the overall game plan, because there's more to taxes than just giving money to the government. Then we're going to look at the players. And Stan, you're going to share with us some really, I think it's a unique perspective, actually, on it. It goes beyond just the accountant when we start talking about taxes. And then our third segment is going to be the 10-yard line, which is really preparing for what's coming up in the next several months, getting your taxes in and how to best prepare for those. So that is the nature of our conversation today. And Stan, I know that your bio is down below in the notes, but what really resonated with me about your story, there was a couple of things. One, you're really you're teach the teachers, right? It basically, because you're out there helping accountants really show up powerfully for business owners. That was one thing that really landed with me. The other thing is man after my own heart, that you are out there empowering people on the topic of financial literacy. And then the third piece, which I think that I'm really excited about what you're bringing to this conversation today. You're not only an accountant, but you mirror or you marry that with financial planning, which I think the conversation, the way it's going to steer, is really about understanding the role of taxes and how that dovetails into our tax strategy, right? And our long-term retirement plan. So that's enough for me. Gab, gab, gab. It is the Gab Lab. But welcome to the show again. Super excited to have you here. You are in Toronto today, correct?
Yeah, where else can you be these days?
At home, in Toronto, around the world, everybody's probably watching from at home. All right, so let's just get right into it. Let's get into the game plan. And if we kind of piggyback off that last conversation or last topic, last point about financial planning and taxes, let's actually go a little bit deeper. I know a lot of people think of taxes as just, again, you know, their obligation every year to get money into the taxes. What's your perspective on taxes?
Well, taxes are, like you said at the beginning, it's one of the necessary taxes, so we've got to deal with it. But what most people don't realize is that taxes can be managed. And it's not managing them on April 29th or June 14th, the day before you have to file the tax return. It begins many, many months before that. It could be January 1st of the previous year, or it could go back even further as making creating a long-term financial and tax planning strategy and having a vision as to where you need to go after having properly taken an inventory of what you currently have and what the tax effects over a period of years is going to be on whatever it is you have, and in some cases, even what you don't have, to utilize, whether you've got losses, whether you've got pregnant gains in investment property or stocks and bonds, and to look at constantly looking at your overall situation. Now, when I say constantly, I don't mean every day and every minute, but to have a regular plan to sit down with your advisor or advisors to see what it is you've got and what their plans or strategies or recommendations are for you. Okay. Now, having said that, one of the things that, you know, briefly touched on when you and I first met is that a lot of people have an accountant. They have a lawyer that they will use from time to time for various matters and situations. And chances are they also have a financial advisor that advises them on investments. And possibly that person may or may not be also an insurance person who's advised them on insurance needs. And what I mean by insurance, I mean life, disability, critical illness, and that type of insurance. But those people generally don't talk to each other. And having spent over 25 years of public practice and 20 years before that in industry and at various levels, and never really seeing those people communicating, I would rarely get a phone call from a financial advisor about how to structure a person's investments as to give them the best tax advantage and future planning and succession planning and estate planning purposes. I would rarely get a call from a lawyer or a lawyer when they were creating a will. And chances are, you know, the other accountants, who, if I was taking over an account from a previous accountant, whether it be personal or corporate, never getting a phone call and saying, was there a strategy that you were utilizing that, or what I can ask, was there a strategy you were employing? And chances are the answer was no. I prepare the financial statements and the tax returns and get it signed and ask them for a check and see you next year kind of thing.
Gotcha. Can I just jump in for a sec? When we're talking about strategy, if when we look at the bigger game plan, I'm curious to hear from you. In my line of work, when I'm putting on my behavioral hat right now, behavioral finance hat, the number of people that actually begrudgingly give their tax dollars away, right, far outweigh the number of people that are seeing their tax dollars and excited about putting their tax dollars to work. High level question for you. How many of your clients are actually, I'm not going to say excited, but how many of your clients are appreciating the value of their tax dollars at work as a percentage, as a ratio, those compared to those that begrudgingly?
They all care about it and they all dislike writing the check. Every one of them.
Okay.
And all dislike writing the check. But having said that, very few are interested in even taking the time to see what it is that they could do to minimize their taxes.
Yeah.
And the memos that I've written over the years, giving tax planning suggestions to clients, inviting to a meeting at their convenience, not necessarily mine, nights, weekends, whenever, and saying, let's sit down and go over this, my recommendations and my strategies. And usually the answer is I'm too busy or I'm going on vacation or whatever. So, and then come the end of the year when I tell them how much tax they owe, they said, gee, that's a lot. And I said, well, we could have done something about it.
Yeah. Stan, you know, when I was doing some research on this, this is the number I pulled up. I could only find it for 2018, but they estimated, this was the Fraser Institute in BC. When they put their numbers together, they came up with 42.5% of our income. Now I'm talking personal taxes here. I'm not talking business taxes, but 42.5% of our income goes to taxes, from federal to municipal to income taxes to mortgage, 42.5, right? Like that is, if that's not a brick over the head to start waking up and understanding, you know, the price that we pay is, so let me just back up there because I think there's two important distinctions and I'll just put my behavioral hat back on. And that is, I personally believe taxes are a form of sharing. It's a form of sharing money. When we look at the reason why we share, it's about social impact, right? Financial impact, social impact, environment impact. And taxes are really just that. The taxes that we pay are going to pay, you know, for our infrastructure, for our roadways, for giving back to others, different social programs that are out there. So just a different way to think of taxes. But then coming back to the game plan, it's really about understanding if 42.5%, if that's what we are currently paying, it would be in our best interest to work with professionals like yourself to try to mitigate some of that, right? To actually put towards our retirement or to put towards repaying our debt. Are you seeing people actually doing that math and being aware of that?
Let me just give you one quick thought. It's not what you earn, it's what you keep.
Okay.
So if you can think about, you know, if you look at somebody says, well, I make $100,000 a year. Well, how much it actually ends up in disposable income or available for investment or what, or paying down debt or whatever it is? Very little of that. And even if you think about the wages that we earn in Canada and the amount of tax that we pay, the wages are high because of the amount of tax that we have to pay. If you think about it, in some situations, we could possibly earn 15 or 20% less if the tax rates were lower and still end up with the same take home.
So I'm sitting with that. Our wages in Canada are higher.
Now that would mean that the corporations or the employers would have more in their pockets, but they would then pay higher taxes on their profits, unless they properly invested it in a tax advantage purpose. So the whole tax system is way out of whack with reality. Not that we can do anything here in today's discussion, but just to keep people aware of it. So like I said, it's not what you earn, it's what you keep.
Okay, so let me just dive into that one for a little bit. It is out of whack, but I think that what's important about this conversation is that we're having it. Can we fix anything today? No, but it always starts with awareness. So can you just clarify for our audience again, why you're feeling our system is in your language, out of whack right now? What is it about the system that's flawed?
Well, first of all, like you just said, it's awareness. So we're here, we're February the 3rd, 2021, and people are starting to think about doing their 2020 taxes, whether it be corporate or whether it be personal. So what I suggest you do is pull out your copy of your 1999 tax return and look at it. See what's on there. See what it is that could have been dealt with otherwise to mitigate, to reduce or mitigate the taxes that you paid in 1999. You're following what I'm saying? Sit down with your accountant now and say, explain to me what went on in this tax return. Because chances are when your 2020 tax return is done or being prepared and you run in there on April 29th to sign it off or whatever, your accountant's going to be too busy to sit down and discuss what's in there with you. Go back now and go through that 1999 tax return with him or her. Find out what went on. Find out what could have been done, what you could still do differently to mitigate taxes, possibly for 2020, even though retroactive tax planning is very difficult. And see what it is that you can do on a go-forward basis. And if you're not getting the answers that you would like and your accountant's not in tune with you, maybe it's time to look for somebody else. Now, also, a lot of the people that are possibly watching this are also business owners. So you've got the interrelationship of their corporate taxes or their businesses and the effect that it has on their personal taxes. So get those things in a line with each other and see what it is that you can do on the corporate side that affects the personal side or vice versa.
So
am I making myself clear?
I believe so. I just want to confirm, though, you're asking us to go back to 1999. So 20 years ago?
I'm sorry, 2019.
Okay, 2019. Gotcha. Okay. I just wanted to confirm that.
Yeah.
I was just thinking, has so much happened in the last two decades that we've completely adapted our tax strategy. Okay, so that makes
a pandemic
really
moment.
Sense. Yeah, that makes really good sense. Learn from our past year, because we can, you know, it's a lot easier to see the rearview mirror, right, and understand what happened or what didn't happen.
Right. And that's a big part of what, and that's a big part of what I preach when I do financial literacy sessions, is look over your previous tax returns. Get an understanding of what your tax return is all about.
Sorry, I have to stop you. Your volume just went way down there, and there's something clicking in the back. It felt like it was shaking, a glass table or something shaking on the table, or no?
Okay now?
You're okay now? And then can you just say the alphabet?
Maybe I was emphasizing something and banging on the table.
Okay, there you go. Okay. Yeah, I think it's good now. It was just like a click, 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 click. Like it was quite fast, but okay. So we'll just take it back from looking at the tax. Looking at the taxes from 19, from 2019. Yeah. Okay. Right. So that makes perfect sense, Stan, to actually take a look at the lessons from the past and how we can apply that learning going into the future. Yeah. Right. Okay. Brilliant. So now if we start thinking about the bigger game plan, I'm feeling a lot of people, and yes, we are in the middle of a pandemic, but it's been my experience that many people are always reactive, right? And they're always looking at their taxes 4 months after year end and going, you know, this is not where I thought I would be. What advice do you give to business owners about understanding their long game, and this is where we marry the planning with taxes, understanding their long game and then understanding their short game and how to better prepare for that using taxes as a vehicle actually in their financial plan?
Well, first of all, in understanding their businesses, they should understand the tax rates that apply to their businesses. So whether their corporation's eligible for small business deductions and what rates they're paying those taxes at, every province is slightly different. Are they taking out dividends? Are they taking out salary from that corporation? What's the most beneficial and expedient way to withdraw earnings to support your lifestyle? What is being reinvested back in the business? Perhaps you've got to put shareholder money back into the business to keep it going or to expand. In a lot of cases. So, and how is that money being treated? What have you done to protect that money that you've lent to the business? Now, I'm getting off of taxes right now, but when you put money into the business, you know, you're providing a loan just like a bank might. Bank will take back security. So if you're putting money in, you should be taking back security as well. But on a tax basis, what is it, on a tax point of view, what is it that money is going to do in the business? Is it going to generate additional revenues and additional profits that's going to be subject to tax, and tax at what rate? Are you buying machinery that's going to be eligible perhaps for a fast write-off for a high capital cost allowance rate? Is it going to be beneficial? Are you going to be, you know, what's the payback that's going to be on that machinery? How are you financing it? Are you leasing it? Are you buying it? What's the advantages of leasing over buying, because there's different tax rates that apply to those different situations. So before you make that expenditure, again, sit down with your accountant and say, what is it, you know, what should I be doing? How should I be acquiring this business? What's going to be the ramifications tax-wise on everything I'm doing here? What's the cash flow that you're projecting out of this? Are you going to have losses in the early years? Are those losses because of this new acquisition and the startup costs and everything else? Will you be able to carry those losses back and get tax refunds because of that? Are you be able to carry those losses forward in the future and create and generate some cash flow from those tax refunds? So those are things that you have to be aware of when you're making an investment in your business. And then what's it going to do personally?
So Stan, what advice do you have for the business owner that comes in? Now, I'm not talking a sole proprietor right now. I'm talking an actual business owner that, regardless of dividends or salary, they're recognized as a director of a business. They've set up a separate entity. What advice do you have for them? Because I think a lot of business owners get very clouded and befuddled when they, you know, they don't see themselves separate over here and then their business over here. It's all one giant cloud. How do you recommend they start separating the two and then first understanding their personal tax situation and their personal long-term game plan, and then how the business is supporting that plan, and then dealing with taxes in the business to actually fuel that long-term game plan?
All right, so another saying that I've heard is when you're a business owner, you're part of the business, but you have to think of yourself as being apart from it. So you have to compartmentalize yourself from that business. They're two distinct entities. You're the individual's an entity. The business is an entity. So separate yourself, whether you're an officer, a director, an employee of that business, and you're also the business owner. So you have to think, are you making the decisions for that business, whether it be tax or anything else, because of your personal needs and wants, or are you doing it because of the business needs and wants? Which it's very difficult to get into that headspace. So what's the impact going to be? Like I said, whether it be tax-wise or business growth-wise, what is it? What's the overriding thing to do here? But again, coming back to your question, is when you're making a decision that's going to affect that business, is it going to increase the value of the business? Hopefully it will. And what's that going to do to your overall wealth situation? What additional plans do you have to make tax-wise if it's going to increase the value of the business? The value of the business is going to increase significantly, possibly over a period of time. And like I said, that value increases. What's the tax plan ultimately to deal with it? Now, what is it that you want to do with that business? You want to keep it for as long as you possibly can and hang on to it with the cold hand reaching out of the grave possibly and never let it go? Is it going to be transitioned to the family? Do you plan to sell it? Do you plan to sell it to a third party, or maybe you're thinking about selling it to your employees? So all these things need to be considered. You know, perhaps you're only 45 or 50 years old now, and you think, well, I'm going to be in this thing for another 25 or 30 years or longer, but stuff happens. Yeah. And if stuff happens, what's going to happen? Tax-wise, wealth-wise, how's it going to be distributed? You know, what's the family needs? Who else do you have to look after? What needs to be retained in the business? And I've seen a lot of businesses fail because of the taxes that had to be paid on the death of a business owner because they didn't properly plan. And I've seen it in younger people, and I've seen it in older people. You know, one I'm dealing with right now, fella's over 90 and four children, and they're trying to figure out what to do with the valuable property that the business owns. And what's their overriding concern right now is paying the taxes.
Yeah.
So it's you can't let taxes always make the decisions for you, because and like I keep pointing out to this family, is if you put this off, it's going to cost you more later. Right now, you've got a tax planning opportunity while everybody's still alive and talking to each other and healthy. When something happens to any one of these individuals, everything's going to change. You're not going to have the same choices that you have while everybody's in the condition to make those decisions and come together. So yeah, the business has to constantly be ready for the unexpected. So, and that's from a tax point of view, that's huge.
Yeah. Well, it's huge. You know, you're definitely speaking my language, because it's beyond the taxes. This is why, I mean, the show is all about taking ownership, getting founders to take ownership of their numbers, not abdicating to bookkeepers, not abdicating to their accountants, not abdicating to their financial planners. Taking ownership, starting with the end in mind, which also includes building that net profit. And I know a lot of business owners will say, well, we don't want the net profit in there. We're only going to get taxed on it, right? But this is what allows you to survive the long game, including pandemic. So to your point, we just never know what's going to happen. The idea is to plan for inevitables. And this is one of our previous solutions, right? Scenario-based testing on the numbers. What would happen if? And so I think that's, you know, your recommendation is brilliant to actually just take ownership of this, look at all the different scenarios, have the tough conversations now, right? So that you're not leaving loved ones in a tough situation. Should something happen, you want to say something, go ahead, Stan.
Yeah, the business is always, you always have to be in condition to put the for sale sign on it if you need to.
I love that. That's another soundbite. You always have to be in the position to put the sale sign on it if you need to. Right. Love it.
And I, you know, I've seen many situations where business owners, they make tax-driven decisions. And like I said, it can't always be a tax-driven decision. And what they do is they do everything they possibly can to keep the profits down so they don't have to pay taxes. But then they turn around and they say, well, I want to sell the business. What's it worth? I said, well, it's not worth anything. And they said, what do you mean it's not worth anything? I said, look at your financial statements. This business has possibly never shown a profit. And if it did, it was minuscule because, you know, you've been a very aggressive in whatever it is that you're doing. And now you want somebody to pay for a business that's not showing any income. Like, give it a shake. Yeah. It doesn't work.
Oh, you're full of sound bites. I love it. Give it a shake. This comes into the planning piece as well. Tell me what your thoughts are on this. But as you know, as I've been working with clients, one of the expense categories that many small business owners aren't even thinking of is setting up a pension plan in their business for themselves and or their employees, and having that as an expense of the business. So they're investing in their future financial situation. It's not necessarily adding to the, you know, that bottom line tax implication there, but this is really where you can get, and I don't want to use the word creative because I know CRA hates that word, but this is where you get efficient and effective, right? With your dollars that come in and don't hide from that bottom line profit.
Right. And you hit a chord with me because I spent probably about 4 months doing road shows on individual pension plans for business owners.
Wow.
And with some specialists on the topic, and showing the value of setting up these individual plans, which are really super duper RSPs. They're supercharged RSPs are what they are. You know, I could go into some detail on it, but is CRA is going to help you pay for your pension, pay your retirement income. If you look at these IPPs, they're a little bit complex to set up. They take some, you have to be able to constantly fund it on a year over year basis. It's like an RSP, but you don't really get a break or be able to take a break from putting the contributions in. So the business has to be able to support the contributions.
Beautiful.
But it's great for for family planning. It's great for the individual planning. And it's a good way to extract profits on a very tax efficient basis.
Love it. Okay, so here's the takeaways I got out of this. Tell me if I'm missing anything or if you think there's another really important nugget in this. But always starting with the end in mind, getting that figured out. It's not what you make, it's what you keep. The other important piece here that I took away from this is for the business owner, I love this soundbite, you're a part of the business, but you have to set yourself apart from the business. So two separate plans and those long-term game plans, you need to know them for both yourself and your business. And your business helps fuel that long-term game plan for yourself personally. Those were my big takeaways. Yeah. And don't shy away from profit.
Yeah, I wish I had brought it today, but I have a hat. And on the front of the hat, it says in. And on the back of the hat, it says on. So when you're wearing it the front way with the brim facing out, it says in. And on the back, if you turn it around, you look like a goof wearing it on. So you can't be working, if you're working in the business, you can't be working on it.
There you go. There's another one. I love it. All right, Stan.
Which way is your hat pointing?
Beautiful. I knew this would be a fun episode, and you have not disappointed. We're having tons of fun. Okay, so this is the end of our first segment, which is all about the game plan. You heard the takeaways there. Please come back and join us. We're going to take a brief intermission, but come back and join us for part two when we start talking about the players now. And before you join part two, please don't forget to subscribe below, share any comments that you might have, and share this forward. If you know of anybody that's trying to figure out how to get their head wrapped around taxes this year, this is an episode they won't want to miss. So thanks for listening, and we'll catch you in part two of quarterbacking your tax return. Bye.